morning, everyone. Yes, my name is Alex Okoro. I'm a member of staff here at the Department of Physics. I did my MS research in this area of automotive, so feel free to ask whatever question you may have. I believe I will be able to answer most of the questions that you have. My area is on solar cells and solar modules, and I'll be able to talk about the history of solar cells, then I'll talk about the solar cell structure, then I'll talk about the photovoltaic technology. Then we see how we come from the solar cell to the module and then to the array. There are certain areas which may overlap with what we covered yesterday, but it's also important in this presentation. So I hope you follow. First of all, I begin with the history of solar cells, and it dates back to the 17th century BC, where, for example, magnifying glasses were used to concentrate sunlight and make fire. Even when we were young in school, I remember we used to play with kind of thing. Then there was also this Swiss scientist who was able to make a hot box. And in that hot box, he placed other boxes inside. And when exposed to solar radiation, the temperature was able to rise up to around 1.8 degrees centigrade. And this particular was hot enough to cook food. Then we also come around 1839, photovoltaic effect was first observed by Becquerel in an electrolytic cell. In that particular cell, current was already seen to increase when irradiated, that is when shown by solar radiation. Then in 1887, photoelectric effect was discovered by Hertz. Then down there I went ahead and defined the photoelectric effect as being a process in which electrons are already emitted from a material that has absorbed sufficient radiation. That is the definition of the photoelectric effect. Then I have a diagram which is a little photoelectric effect. Here you have solar radiation which comes from the sun. It falls on the material, and as a result, the electrons are emitted from that material. That is what we call the photoelectric effect. Then in 1905, Albert Einstein was able to explain the electric effect by assuming that light energy is made of quantized packets of energy, which are called photons. He was actually trying to explain what was happening. This is diagram here. He assumed that inside this solar radiation, there are packets of energy which are called photons. Once they fall on this material, they absorb sufficient energy, and because they have higher energy, they are able to come off that material. Then in 1918, the high quality crystalline materials were first developed, and it is the method which we were talking about yesterday in the afternoon. Yeah, so that is the method they are still using even up to today to develop solar energy materials. Then in 1953, the theoretical calculations were made on the solar performances for materials with different band gaps. And in 1954, real development of solar cells with conversion efficiency of 6% was done in the US. Here, the computation of 6% is done in such a way that they usually consider how many photons are incident onto a material. And then you remember that they say that it is only the important we have a certain amount of energy that are able to destroy any electron from a material. So in this case, when you talk about 6%, we think that it is only about 6% of the incident photons which are able to produce electricity. Then thereafter, what follows, many companies and laboratories that have developed silicon-based solar cells to power satellites orbiting the Earth. Then in the 1970s, solar cell based on gallium arsenide junction was developed, and this was the name of the scientist who did that. And that was based on group 3 to group 5 semiconductor materials. Then in 1976, we had thin-film photovoltaic devices based on amorphous silicon thin film. Then in 1978, Sharp and Tokyo Electronics developed the first solar-powered calculators, which are actually still in use today. Then in 1980, the first thin film solar cell based on copper sulfide stroke that cadmium sulfide junction was demonstrated with a conversion efficiency of 10%. Then in 1991, organic solar cells were first published in Switzerland, and I think those were the trends in the history of solar cells. And actually, this is what was happening along all that time. You can see here that in the 50s and through the 70s, what was driving the development of solar cells was space applications, such as in satellites. And then from the 1970 up to 1980, there was the oil crisis, and the people went into serious research on photovoltaics. And then today, what is mainly driving the development of photovoltaics is the need for cleaner energy. So briefly, actually, that is what we can say about the history of solar cells. Then I'll also talk about the solar cell structure, which here is defined as an electronic device which directly converts sunlight to electricity. I already said that its operation is based on the photoelectric effect, in which when solar radiation falls on a material, it's able to absorb a photon of energy, and as a result of absorbing that energy, an electron or more is promoted to a higher energy level. And as a result, if that electron is allowed to flow in an external circuit, then a current flows. Then here I put it right that light produces both a current and a voltage to generate electric power. Then I have the diagram of a cell. This is the rear contact, and at this point here we call this the base, and then this is the emitter, this is the contact, and this is also the contact. So we have solar radiation which comes from the sun, falls onto the material, and then it creates an electron hole there. An electron is positively charged, while a hole is positively charged. If an external circuit exists, this electron here is able to flow through the material, and then it dissipates energy in the external load, and then to do flow back to the cell. Here I also also talked about the material which is used in solar cells. In particular, it should be a material in which absorption of light raises electrons to higher energy state, and then the movement of this higher energy electron from the cell to an external circuit should also be possible, because it is actually the motion of the electron which constitutes a current. Then the high energy electron should be able to dissipate that energy in an external circuit and then returns to the solar cell. And semiconductor in form of a PN junction are the ones which are used in most cases. Then here I talked about the solar cell operation, and I say the above process is based on the photovoltaic effect, which is defined as the generation of a voltage difference at the junction of two different materials in response to visible or other radiation. The absorption of light generates carriers, and then the generated charge carriers are separated and eventually collected at the respective electrodes. Here I have once again the solar cell. You have radiation which comes from the sun and falls onto the solar cell. Here you have the negative charges, which in this case are the electrons, and here you have the holes which travel downwards while the negative charges travel upward. If an external circuit exists, the current will flow into the external circuit and then it will dissipate its energy to this external load. Then I also want to talk about photovoltaic technologies, which you covered yesterday. On that diagram, you can see that you have some solar panels which are already mounted. Then when I come down here, we also have this other type here. And then down there, I have another third type. So this particular one is the monocrystalline type. And then this is the polycrystalline. And then this is the amorphous type. So the solar cell technologies which we talk about the crystalline silicon, then stimulate them group 3 to 4 cells. But we shall concentrate mainly on the crystalline silicon and then the stimulate solar cells. Crystalline silicon is the most common in our Ugandan market, and the advantage is it has that the processing standards are well known, and then also the silicon materials which are used in solar cells are very abundant. Actually, it is the second most abundant mineral in the world, second to oxygen. So it's actually everywhere. The disadvantage is that it requires expensive and high pure silicon. And then it also competes with silicon with the electronics industry. You talked about this yesterday. I said carefully made silicon forms crystals, and the carefully made silicon forms crystals, and there we have single crystalline silicon, we have polycrystalline silicon, and above us silicon. The main difference between each is the crystal grain size and their growth technique. There I have a diagram which shows the patterns of atoms in a single crystalline silicon. Yesterday, in one of the presentations, they explained how single crystalline silicon is made. complaining. And somewhere I remember saying that they usually cut, they cut off a slice from a wafer. Now inside that wafer, this is what is usually there. You have an even pattern of atoms in a single crystalline wafer of a cell. Then here I also talked about a growth techniques which I used, and this was explained yesterday. And one of the methods is this one. Then, and the down there we have what usually takes place, some of the advantages and the disadvantages. Then here I also talked about the advantages of monocrystalline zircon. Well, one of the advantages is that it has the highest efficiency because they use a high-grade zircon, and the conversion efficiency there is only between 15% and 20%. Then they also require the this amount of space. That is if you are installing them, because of their higher efficiency, you may only need one solar panel, which is 50 watt, and it would only take a very small space as compared to a professional one. Then it also has a long lifespan of about 25 years. In some books they talk of 30 years, but what I was reading here was able to watch 25 years. They also tend to perform better than similarly rated polycrystalline solar panels at low light conditions. That is to say that in the areas where the weather is always warm, not too hot, it will always perform best in that region. Then the disadvantages are out there that they are the most expensive because in that case you are using very poor silicon, which are usually very difficult to purify. And then they only tend to be more efficient only in warm weather. That is the unfortunate bit of it. Because for example in Uganda here, the temperatures are usually very hot, and because of that, as the temperature increases, the efficiency decreases also. So there should always be a mechanism of how to cool the solar panel so that it only remains warm. Otherwise, the efficiency will keep dropping as the temperature of the solar panel increases. Here I have the polycrystalline atoms. This is usually the arrangement in the wafers after cutting. You have this part, and then you have that there. You have already fixed up in a way. And once again, I say there is a significant difference in the size of the grains. The advantage is that it's cheaper because they are feeding it. Not very pure silicon. It is also faster processing. Then the disadvantage there is that it has lower conversion efficiency of around only 13% to 16%. Then it has lower space efficiency, meaning that as compared to monocrystalline silicon, you will already require a bigger space. For example, if you had to install a 50-watt solar panel, if you are using a monocrystalline, you may only require one solar panel, whereas for this, you may require even about two, and so on. That's what they mean by space efficiency. Then it has lower heat tolerance than a monocrystalline, meaning that for it doesn't withstand heat for a very long time, the efficiency begins to drop as the temperature is increasing. It drops at a higher rate as compared to the monocrystalline silver. That is briefly what I can talk about, the technologies which I use. Then here I want to talk about how we come from a solar cell to a module and then to another array. Generally speaking, a single solar cell has a voltage of only about 0.5 to 0.6 volts. And that is very small to do anything. It may not even run a watt. So to always produce a larger voltage, you have to add up very many solar cells and then to put it in a tough weather resistant package to form what is called a module. A typical module may have either about 36, 54, 74, or 96 in series. And then these cells here, which I mentioned, that they're either 36, 54, or 72. They form what is called a solar module. And when we connect solar modules either in series or parallel, we form what is called an array of modules. I'll explain this in details in the next slide. Here I have a single solar cell. It has the following contacts here. One is either positive or negative. And then it's I would also like to talk about series and parallel connection of solar cells. Here you observe that we have one cell is connected directly from this one to that, and then this and this is also connected to that in that way, and then afterwards you have this one connected backwards, this side. This kind of connection is what is called the series connection. Then we also have the parallel connection of cells, whereby each of these points is connected to one line, and then each of these sides is connected to one line, and after all of them are joined together. This is what is called the parallel connection of cells. Then here we have the IV characteristics, or rather the current voltage characteristics of a solar cell. In the first part here, if you have a single cell and you are able to perform an experiment, that is if you are able to, if you have solar radiation and you go ahead and measure current as well as voltage, after plotting, you will trace a curve which is like that. It begins from there and then it drops off at this point there. This is the maximum voltage which you can get from the solar cell, and it is usually called the open circuit voltage, and then this is called the short circuit voltage. You can see that if you have a series connection, it is the same current which flows through the cell. I'll take you back to the diagram briefly. Here we have the series connection. You can see that it is the same current which flows through the cell all the way, and then it comes back up to that point. That is why here on the diagram I have one horizontal line from there. Oh, this is a single cell, then if you have a second solar cell in that position. So you will have the same current flowing, but then the voltage from the cell increases. That is if the cells are connected in series. On the other hand, if the cells are connected in parallel, then the current increases, but then you get the same voltage. That is to say, if a cell which you are using had only 6 volts and you connected them in parallel, even if you have about 10 solar cells, but all of them are in parallel, you will still get only 6 volts. And if you connected the cells in series, and a single solar cell, say if it had one amp, and you connected those cells, but if you had 20 cells, but they're in series, they will give you the same current, but then the voltage is what will be increased in that case. So this idea is usually what is normally used in building a solar module, either to increase the current or to increase the increase the voltage. Here I have an IV car for the number of solar cells. The first one here, from this point up to this, as you can see, one cell is only able to give 0.6 volts, and then it will give some current there, which I indicated as ISC, that is the short circuit current. Then if you added a second cell to decrease up to that point, and so on and so forth. So the more cells you have, the more the voltage you will get. That is if they are connected in series. And then the overall IV characteristics would be the biggest one there. And the voltage you will have here would be 21.6 volts. And as I told you earlier, that a cell has only 0.6 volts. So to increase the voltage across a solar module, you only have to multiply how many solar cells you have times 0.6 volts to arrive at 21.6. Then here I also talked about how you can connect a solar module to get a bigger voltage. For example, a TV. A TV may operate at about 240 volts AC. So how can we achieve that bigger voltage? And yet we have only a PV module of only about 21.6 volts. In that case, what you have to do, you have to go ahead and you connect the solar module in series, and in that case, you are increasing the voltage output from the PV module. In that case, you have the overall voltage would be visible to V1, where V1 is the voltage across the first solar module. Then V2 is the voltage across second module, and then V3, the voltage across the third module. In that way, we are able to build even a bigger and bigger voltage from a solar module. On the other hand, the current here remains the same throughout, for as long as we are connecting these solar modules in series. Then we also have the parallel connection of modules, whereby it is the current which increases. The first solar module had a current around this position. When you add the second module, the current increases to that position, and then eventually to that position. But then the PD across the solar modules will always remain the same. Total current here is given by I is equal to I1 plus I2 plus I3, whereby The IE123 and the current which flows through these modules respectively. But the potential difference, as you can see here, is the same for all solar PV modules. Then we also have a combination where you have both series and parallel connection of modules. Here you have this module here is in series with this, and likewise these ones are in series. But overall, this combination is in parallel that one. So the connection here, you have this particular one would produce this IV curve, then this particular one produces that, that one particular produces that, and so on and so forth. Also, we have this one will produce this, and that one produces that, and that produces that. And then overall, for the entire combination, you will have a big current which comes out of this, and then you have also bigger voltage there. Overall, we began from a single solar cell, and then we connected either in series or parallel to form what is called a module. Then from a module, you connect those modules either also in series and parallel to form what is called a solar array. That is briefly what I prepared for you. Thank you for listening.
Here, as you can see, this is one. So
solar PV module, this is another one, this is another one, that is another one, this is another one. There are eight at this point, and an array. They are either in parallel or they are in series, depending on what your interest is. I hope that answers you.